This is a day to celebrate, right? Celebrate, okay? So I'm going to give this talk in this mode of celebration. I'll probably gesture and jump around and knock the microphone off myself and that kind of thing. I was actually thinking I'd have to wake you up, but now you're all ready to go, right? So I've got a relatively short period of time to tell you about a tremendous amount of research on animals that's been done at Hubbard Brook. But I actually want to start out by thanking all of the literally hundreds of people who have been involved in research on animals here as a part of the Hubbard Brook Ecosystem Study that's gone on, of course, we know, for this 50 years. So how many of you actually have been involved in those animal studies? I want you to raise your hand or stand up. We're always in the minority, but we're strong, right? Okay. And we make a lot of noise, all right? So I'm talking about not just the forest and the birds, even though that's where I do my research, but I'm talking about all of the Hubbard Brook ecosystems, the lakes, the streams, as well as the forest. And in order to cover this broad research topic, somebody kill that light because it's blinding me. All right, to cover this topic, I thought to do this in a novel way, I'd talk about the diversity of ideas studied by using animals. And how do you get a handle on that from 50 years of research, you know? So I said, all right, I'm going to go through every single publication that's been done as a part of the Hubbard Brook research effort here, and I'm going to identify what ideas were studied by using which animals. That took a heck of a long time, and of course I can only tell you about a few of those ideas and the discoveries made, but it was quite illuminating. So pay attention to the pictures, because an awful lot of that research is going to show up in the pictures of these animals. As I said, I can only tell you about a few of the ideas and discoveries, but I'm going to speculate wildly, as I usually do along the way, about topics for future research that come out of this large body of research in the past, and I'm going to end with a celebration of the animals here at Hubbard Brook. The pictures that you're looking at here now have to do with the kinds of methods used to study animals. Many people think that if you go into the forest with an ornithologist, you got binoculars and you do observational studies, right? Well, sure, a lot of the research has been done using observational studies, but you can see towers and backpacks on birds and nets and dropping nutrients and spraying pesticides and exclosures. So there's been a broad array of kinds of experimental methods used to do research on animals as well. So last thing I need to say on this slide is, how do you organize a talk that's about a diversity of animals? There's no plan that you can use. So to organize this wildly diverse group of ideas, this forest of ideas, I said, oh, do it alphabetically. So here you go. Acidification. You've heard about acidification. You know, most of the history of Hubbard Brook research has been studies has been replete with studies of acidification. We have studies on the acid tolerance of stoneflies, aluminum toxicity for zooplanktons. We have the effects on stream communities and drift of aquatic organisms. We have the potential for thinning of eggshells in birds. And we have population level studies on calcium dependent species like snails and how that was affected by the loss of calcium. So there's an incredible diverse array of studies on acidification, and I'm going to show you one result, okay? One result. So what you see here is the density of drifting organisms in a stream, Norris Brook, just down the hill here. Here we have the reference stream at the bottom, the solid line. Here we have the experimentally acidified stream, and you can see there was a dramatic increase in drifting organisms as a consequence of experimental acidification. Clearly, acidification was a problem that had to be addressed, and you've heard in numerous talks how Hubbard Brook Research has contributed significantly to addressing this problem. I'll only note, as probably others have too, that in fact, we're just beginning now to see the legacy effects of acidification happening in each one of these ecosystems, the streams, Mirror Lake, and the forest. And so it's going to be interesting to follow this through the future, looking at new effects, potentially, on animal populations. Next, bioaccumulation. In the early 1970s, there was quite a bit of interest in bioaccumulation, and we had bioaccumulation of lead and copper and cadmium measured in a wide array of organisms, from small mammals to fish. Almost invariably, they found above background levels of these pollutants, and to my knowledge, though, no study actually showed a population level effect of any of these heavy metals on the organisms. However, if you look back at the numbers for small mammals, they actually were above harmful levels by today's lead standards, all right? Once again, more recent emphasis has been on mercury, and Charlie gave us a nice introduction to those ideas, but we had an undergraduate from Wellesley who studied the mercury concentration in spiders and its effects on webs, and indeed, again, no harmful behavioral effects on the spiders. Interesting thing about this, though, is that none of this research has actually been followed up on since the period of the 1970s. I mean, lead, cadmium, copper. So I was hoping Bill Schlesinger would be here. He did some of that work, but I didn't see him. And so, you know, somebody else besides Bill, I guess, is going to have to do it here in the future. Oh, next, a lot of interest in climate, weather, and climate change. And, of course, Peter Groffman just led the team of authors on a paper that came out in Bioscience that summarized the Hubbard Brook research on this important topic. But here, once again, lots of interesting research has gone on. We have snow removal studies that show negative effects on microarthropods in the forest floor. When snowpack is scarce, the moose mow the hobble bush, potentially influencing nesting habitat for birds, and indeed exposing them to that brain nematode that's not harmful to the white-tailed deer, but deadly to the moose. We've got caterpillars that find what we call enemy-free space at cool areas, high elevation areas in the valley. And for salamanders, it looks like drought could be harmful because it influences their foraging, but in fact, more flow in headwater streams might actually be beneficial. So you can see probably a lot more research is going to be going on to understand the potential effects of climate change on the Hubbard Brook organisms. I'm just showing you one tidbit from most of these topics that I'm covering. Here's an early study, came out in 2001 by Sillette and Holmes, that's showing the relationship between the Southern Oscillation Index, think the El Nino cycle, and the survival during winter of black-throated blue warblers. We're looking at here the correlation between the black line and the gray line. Note how they track each other very carefully or closely. When survivorship is low in the winter, it's when those winters are dry. And the projection is for a continued drying out of the Caribbean basin. This isn't good news for the migratory songbirds that overwinter there. Beyond climate change, tremendous amount of interest in communities here at Hubbard Brook. We have communities of zooplankton, communities of salamanders, communities of fish have been studied, communities of birds, communities of microarthropods, even micrometazoans in the benthos of Mirror Lake have been studied from a community organization and structure and functional fashion. So a lot of interesting ideas here. What I would suggest is, it doesn't have to be the same old way we studied communities, right? Usually we'd say, oh, the bird community, or the fish community, or the zooplankton community. Why don't we start studying functional groups, like the community of organisms that all feed on caterpillars, or the community of organisms that all parasitize those eastern newts? Might be a different way of thinking about communities. We've had interesting, call them visionary, studies in the past on communities. Here's a couple of them. One by Holmes, Bonney, and Pakala used foraging behavior of birds to identify three groups of birds that use the forest resources differently. They called those guilds of birds. We have the ground foragers that forage on or near the ground, the bark foragers that use the bark on branches or trunks, and gleaners that forage above the ground in the foliage and twigs. Lane McCarowitz in Lichens actually published an interesting paper that quantified the niche space for zooplankton in Mirror Lake by measuring abundance across depth and time. Both of these papers contributed to basic general understanding about how communities were structured and how dynamic those communities were. Animals are mobile. Maybe that's their most interesting feature. That's why we're going to go out on a tour and watch the animals this afternoon, right? Animals are mobile. But it also raises lots of interesting questions about them, like linkages across habitats, the spatial scales of movement and dispersion, whether the choices that animals make, like whether to settle and stay or move, and indeed the genetic patterning that results as a consequence of those choices that the animals make. Now, some animals of all populations move during their lifetimes. And so we've got some that are highly mobile, like migratory songbirds. Interesting question there. But what about those animals that seem much less mobile, like the aquatic insects or salamanders? So I'm going to feature a couple of these less mobile dispersers here and look at some of the interesting results that have been found there. What we have here on the left for salamanders, work by Windsor Lau and co-workers, genetic distance in relationship to physical distance. And you see very different patterns, okay, for two different species of salamanders. One that has a downstream bias in its dispersal, the other which has an upstream bias in its dispersal. Really interesting. Genetic patterning is matching dispersal tendency here. Kate McNeil, in a mark recapture study of stoneflies, showed that these stoneflies are biasing their, here's zero, biasing their dispersal upstream. But the more interesting thing is that some of these seemingly weak flyers are moving over a half a kilometer upstream or through the forest to find a new stream. So fascinating results about from the movement of animals. I said it was going to be alphabetical, so here we go with energy flow and energy budgets. Lots of research on this in the 1970s. The words of production, biomass, caloric density, energetics appeared over and over in different kinds of papers for different taxa of animals. We're talking about birds and salamanders and white-tailed deer and the benthos of Mirror Lake. It's amazing to me when I look back at it and say, here's this interesting body of work. It looks to me like a golden age of collaboration. Maybe Gene can comment on that. But many different types of people who are doing very different kinds of work, all kind of focusing on the same ideas. How are we going to quantify energy flows and energy budgets? Again, I can only feature one single figure from all of this, but it's a textbook figure. It used to be in the textbooks. I don't honestly know much about what's in the textbooks anymore. But you can see the broad flow patterns represent the amount of energy coming in and then distributed amongst the compartments of this forested ecosystem. And there's some features of this that, you know, continue to surprise me. First, this highly evolved system, I think John Battles used those words about these highly evolved forest ecosystems. They're only 2% efficient at capturing sunlight energy. Come on, give me something could be better than that. And then these forests, what do? 74% of net primary production on an annual basis is dumped into the decomposer food web. I thought it was supposed to grow trees, right? No wonder these forests aren't working well, right? But the most disappointing part is only less than 1% is consumed by my interesting birds and caterpillars. Just think, if we could get that up to 3% or 5%, there'd be birds all over the place, right? So, fascinating summary of research. I wish I knew the story behind this article because it came out in Scientific American. It's one of the few energy budget summaries from all of that work by all these people came out in Scientific American. But Jim Goss probably isn't here. I've never met him. Anyhow, maybe Gene or Dick or somebody knows the story. We also were interested in those years in ecosystem function and nutrient cycling and how animals might contribute to things like the functioning of an ecosystem. Well, you got to measure things in order to get numbers to do that. So what do we have in the literature? We have numbers on the calcium content of birds, the phosphorus content of moths, how much nitrogen a mouse eats in a year. And we have things like budgets of these things for benthos in Mirror Lake. And we have the contribution of moose to nitrogen cycling. Lots of really interesting ideas. And it turns out when you start to quantify things, even simple things it seems, right? Interesting results appear. And I highlighted a couple of them in the red. What you see on left is the nitrogen requirement of a female white-tailed deer for a year, right? Well, I thought it was, you know, tough to raise children. 3.3% of the nitrogen budget's all it takes to raise a fawn. Staying alive, I guess, is the tough part, not raising children. If you look on the right, annual ingestion of nutrients by salamanders as a percentage of above-ground litter fall of those nutrients. Here we go. Less than 1% for almost all of these different kinds of nutrients, with the exception of sodium, 8%. I actually read this paper because I was really curious about that 8%. And Burton and Likens, they just left the reader hanging. what on earth are the salamanders doing with 8% of the sodium? White-tailed deer were supposedly limited by sodium. They should have been eating salamanders, right? All right, so quantifying things leads to surprising results. Of course, to obtain food and energy, you've got to eat things. So foraging, diets, food limitation all show up. Lots of novel ideas and interesting experimental tests going on here. We have a food limitation in birds. We have diet preferences of caterpillars. We have male to female differences in salamander foraging behavior. We have this food supply dynamics for stream insects. Fascinating research that's going on in these animals. And I'm just going to skip the results there and jump onto the next one, because most of those animals were obtaining food via predation and herbivory, right? So what do we have so far for predation and herbivory? We have squirrels, predation on nuts, and we have small herbivores like caterpillars that are actually the dominant caterpillars of the forest. And we also have moose as our herbivores. But we had predation and herbivory in stream insects as well. We have studies of the effects of bird predation on forest Lepidoptera. And we even have density-dependent nest predation for birds. So lots of interesting ideas. I'm just going to highlight a couple of them again. And pardon me if I'm putting too much emphasis on birds, you know. But hey, what can you say? There's a lot to choose from. All right, so what we have on the left here is caterpillar abundance over time. And what you can see is Lepidoptera abundance inside exclosures on the top and outside exclosures, exclosing birds, right? So what Dick and Jack Schultz showed is that, in fact, birds were reducing the abundance of caterpillars in the forest, reducing their own food supply. What we have on the right is the figure that actually demonstrated Ian Baldwin's idea of the talking trees hypothesis. All right? We have two measures of leaf defense over here on the x-axis or y-axis, and we have time on the x-axis. There are three treatments in this experiment. The D represents saplings with damaged leaves, damaged as if an herbivore was feeding on them. The X represents what were called communication controls, leaves exposed to the same air as the damaged leaves. And then we have the real, actual controls that were isolated from the communication controls and the damaged leaves. And you see in both cases, by these different measures, the communication controls are responding more like the damaged leaves in producing defensive chemistry than they are the actual controls, showing that these plants are communicating with each other via volatile compounds passed through the air. Population dynamics, regulation, limitation was an important part, because if you're going to understand the impact of animals in ecosystems, you need to know something about their abundance. So what factors were driving changes in abundance were a part of all of these kinds of studies. And so we have papers on the size of populations, population cycles and outbreaks in caterpillars. We have studies on the growth rates and trends of zooplankton and birds. We have linkages across habitats for stream insects and salamanders. We have density-dependent reproduction in birds, and we have even the concordant population dynamics of scores, if not hundreds, of species of moths in the forest. Tremendous amount of interesting ideas here that I'm just trying to capture under a few of these same general titles. And I'm just showing you this figure that you've seen before, but for me what it represents is a lot of change over the 50-year period of the Hubbard Brook ecosystem study. Now, I know Dick's study is only a mere 45 years long, you know, but it shows a trend, right? We've seen a dramatic decrease in the abundance of birds in the forest. To see if that was a general pattern, because of course this blue line represents just a 10-hectare plot west of Watershed 6, Dick had researchers out there quantifying bird abundance in the same methods on three other sites in the White Mountains region, and you can see, in fact, they all changed in near unison over that 15-year period. The result was general, but what was the cause? It turned out probably the primary cause was the aging of the forest, because most of this drop here was due to species associated with early and mid-successional forest types. Gene pointed out, this might be an optimistic trend. It's a day for celebration and optimism, right? So I'm going to speculate wildly. We're just sitting, waiting for a big bump up. And why is that going to happen? Because we had thousands of trees go down in the forest just a few weeks ago, opening up big gaps, allowing young forest to regrow in those gaps. Young forest, lots of release of nutrients, as we saw from the whole watershed treatments on watershed 2 and watershed 6. You know, if you have reduced transpiration, warmer soils, lots of decomposition, nutrient inputs, that's good for early successional trees, and it's good for caterpillars, and that means it's good for birds, right? So, this is the end of my story. I stop right here. No more to tell you about research, except that there's a tremendous list of other ideas I couldn't get to. My first list was 160 ideas long. I had to collapse them even to finish on this page. But where are we going from here? We're going from things like activity polymorphisms to weight loss, something some of us older folks should think more about, I guess. All right. But I want you on your feet now, because it's a day of celebration. So stand up again. We're going to celebrate biodiversity at Hubbard, Brook, and we're going to do it to one of the hottest tunes of 1963. This is the California sound of the Safaris.
Energy, and as does lots of the issues and the importance of the work that he talked about. We do have some time for questions.
Sure. Okay. Rakesh.
I was wondering the example you gave about defense compounds.
Hmm.
Were the X leaves, you know, caterpillar damages and all that, were they from the same trees?
No. Different trees, different pots. It was actually a pot study with little enclosures, and there was only air communication between different trees and different pots. It was not on the same tree. Yeah.
Another connected question to government is about the heavy metals that you said there were no behavioral changes with heavy metals.
To my knowledge, I added that. Does anybody know differently? I don't remember a study that actually showed in the forest population level effects. I don't know if anybody did lab studies on behavior. They've done elsewhere, and they actually showed behavioral effects. I know some at Miami University.
All right.
I don't know. Yeah.
This may be a question for Dick Holmes if he's still in the room, but the resurgence of bird populations, is that related to one or two species that are doing extraordinarily well and others that are declining, or is it a more generalized increase in all species?
That is an answer. Dick is going to give you the answer to this, but I'm going to say, first of all, I'll bet anything he says, that isn't a resurgence. Wait for the long-term data.
So if you can just repeat Dick's answer to make sure that everyone could hear.
So Dick's answer was there are multiple species that are actually increasing, showing you that small but seemingly long-term rise near the end of the record. Yeah. Yeah.
In the Colebrook area, I'm hearing from people who have been longtime bird feeders that they're seeing far fewer species and far fewer numbers of those species. I have a camp in the middle of the Connecticut Lakes Headwaters Tract. It's a hike-end camp. We used to hear many, many different kinds of species of songbirds. And over not a very long period, about 15 years, we're hearing very few. And that is an excellent bird habitat. It's a lot of a diverse habitat, clear cuts, regrowth, and mature forest. Everything you'd want, shoreline included. I call people who are far more learned on birds than I am. And the one thing I have not heard at this gathering is the effect on winter habitat in Central America, which people seem to think is at the root of this, given that we have good habitat.
Yeah. So the question is, could winter habitat changes be reducing abundances of a variety of bird species? Because many of our migratory birds actually winter in the tropics. I wish Dick was answering this question,
too.
There isn't anything solid on that at this point, all right? Basically, if you look at the breeding bird survey data or more recently eBird data, you know, there's always going to be patchy changes in populations. They're spreading around in the environment, you know? But there don't seem to be, except for a few species increasing, black-throated greens, oven birds, a few species increasing, you know, significant declines in forest birds. And we're just talking here about forest birds. We go to grassland birds or edge birds, a lot of changes there. So I don't know. You know, I'd say, you know, we'd have to really look closely at the data, but pointing the finger at the tropics, I'm not sure we can do that yet. You know, because not all of them. For example, yellow rump warblers winter way down in the tropics. Some of them actually overwinter in southeastern United States. So winter wren's another one. You know, so I don't. You'd have to think about particular species of birds, and we'd have to get into the actual data, breeding bird survey data, or something like that, in order to come up with a potential explanation. But I don't see it right now. From what I know, that there's great concern about precipitous declines in forest songbirds. Might happen with drying out of the Caribbean, but right at the moment, I don't think the data shows that's happening.
You mentioned near the end of your talk that with the preference to windrow and early successional gaps, that that's good for birds. So is it good for birds that quality breeding habitat or pre-migration feeding?
Bugs. Bugs, 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 bugs. Caterpillars, moths.
All the things you don't like, they love.
Well, mosquitoes and black flies are too small to bother with, right? You know, so, but I'd say right now, what the Hubbard Brook data shows is that the numbers of birds returning in the next year is dependent on reproduction in the current year here. That there isn't a real strong signal from the tropics, although there are some studies, Pete Mara's done some good work, to show there are clear connections between wintering area and the breeding success of birds in the breeding areas, all right? So winter conditions influence when they leave, how fast they migrate, their condition on arrival, and their reproductive success for American redstarts, at least, all right? So, yeah, I don't, you know, if I wanted to say, let's do something great for birds, more caterpillars. And that's associated with these early successional forests, typically, because they have higher nitrogen content in their leaves.
And it just has by way of follow-up, I mean, just what's the inverse there is that you have less older complex forests, and I'm assuming that's got to be good for birds too. Is that wrong, or do we really just care about birds and their breeding habitat? So we should just
No. Indeed, in fact, I argued against that from the state of Massachusetts' point of view. They wanted to actually go in and create patches in old growth forest. Well, probably old forests are the most resistant kinds of forests to impending climate change, all right? So we have to be judicious. Here we had a lot of blowdowns all of a sudden, and we didn't expect it, right? So nature's going to take every opportunity to keep the forest dynamic. I don't think we need to get in there and manipulate the forest by making younger forests to support birds. It's going to happen on its own.
I will admit, I just made you. Thank you.
One last question. Go
ahead. Anything with climate change movements?
Movement of?
Winter birds being... Northern birds not showing up and more southern birds showing up?
Well, there is a definite signal, and during the Hubbard Brook meetings, Nina Laney is going to talk about it, that in fact the birds are breeding earlier. There's some signal that they're arriving earlier.
Different species starting to show up?
Well, not so much in the forest. Okay. Well, no, that's not true. American turkeys are here now. Have we had a... Dick, have we had a... red-bellied woodpecker in the forest yet?
Last year.
Yeah. So there are some southern species that are definitely moving in. It was a number of years ago that the blue-gray gnatcatchers came north, you know. So they're definitely, but you can't, you know, be careful pointing the finger and saying, oh, climate change did that. You know? I'm not sure. We don't certainly have conclusive evidence that climate change is the only...
Is not here anymore? Ravens.
Philadelphia vireo, would you call it a northern bird that's not here anymore?
Not here, but habitat's changed, so it's now suitable.
So it could be habitat, not climate change. Yeah.
So on that, we're going to need to transition, but I think if Nick could give Lindsay the mic. So thank you very much.